200 episodes. My Little Pony has come a long way. Now it's time we see a sibling rivalry. Shall we get down to business? This series has come a long way since Lauren Faust set its roots back on October 2010. Before we review this episode, let me talk about my own experiences. As such, we'll use clips from previous episodes.
The ponies refuse to move their trees, so we are stuck here, and it is not fair!
I first got into the franchise back in August of 2011, all thanks to some Gary's Mods videos involving Pinkie Pie and the others. Since then, I have enjoyed the franchise as much as I enjoyed other shows like Animaniacs and Star Wars The Clone Wars. And the funny thing is, I actually grew up watching a bit of the original Generation series of My Little Pony, ironically more than Transformers Generation 1 or G.I. Joe, especially the side series The Glow Friends. Trust me, that was actually pretty fun back then. But like how Transformers always carried its legacy into future installments, My Little Pony did the same thing as well, carrying its past legacy into the series with familiar Generation 1 faces like Applejack and Spike, as well as G3 characters like Rainbow Dash and Pinkie Pie. But when they confirmed T-Rex of all characters, I was excited! This was the first My Little Pony villain reimagined into the current series, and the fact that he topped his Generation 1 counterpart made it all the worthwhile.
We don't have time for that sort of thing.
This series was also responsible for bringing out the artist within me. I wasn't a good illustrator back then, but now, I wound up coming out as an artist, showcasing what I can do with talking ponies. In terms of characters, I enjoy drawing Pinkie Pie, Rarity, Starlight Glimmer, Cozy Glow, Derpy Hooves, Discord, Princess Celestia, T-Rex, and even Grogar. Sure, I like to draw other characters, but these are the ones that I enjoy sketching out the most. The best part about this series was meeting the cast and crew in person. Mostly they were at the San Diego Comic-Con like Lauren Faust, Tara Strong, Jim Miller, Tabitha St. Germain, Andrea Libman, Nicole Dubois, Vincent Tong, Rachel Bloom, and even William Shatner. Outside of Comic-Con, I was able to meet other voice actors like Peter New, Rena Inokwe, Nicole Oliver, Kelly Sheridan, and Kira Azani. These are memories that I will keep with me until my time on this earth ends.
No! You must undo what you've done!
What? Why?
My only criticism of this generation? I wish there was a console or PC game and not just the smartphone games. It would have been fun to see our favorite ponies in a LEGO-style video game, a Zelda-based adventure game, or even a nod to Dynasty Warriors in terms of gameplay. That's the one major shame about My Little Pony Friendship is Magic. All that magic in one show, and no true adventure game to journey across Equestria from any video game team, not even Nintendo. Oh well, maybe in the next generation, if I'm lucky.
I'm so sorry, I missed you so much, big sister.
With the series concluding soon, all I can say is it's been a fun ride with My Little Pony, and no matter what anyone says about the series, I wouldn't trade it for anything else in the world. Even when the series ends, I will continue to produce as much content to keep its spirit alive. Anyway, let's move on with our review of the episode.
I've taken the security here to a whole new level.
What I loved about this episode was that it was a nod to the iconic heist film, Ocean's 11. In terms of character, Shining Armor was effective as the main antagonist of the story. I always wanted to see Shining Armor as a smug older brother to Twilight Sparkle, and I hope we see more of this before the series ends. Maybe Shining Armor unleashing a swarm of ladybugs on Twilight's castle, or tormenting her with an extra cheesy quesadilla.
Pinkie Party rarity costumes? Sign the future sibling supreme? Oh, come on!
This also contributes to the comical part of the episode, especially involving Twilight trying to figure out how to outsmart her big brother, all while he anticipates her every move. I think this is the reason why we don't see Twilight mature into a wiser pony, and I'm actually fine with it. Well, that and seeing a more immature side of Celestia and Luna. Way to neglect your own sister, Cake Flank.
How are we meant to shake down ne'er-do-wells for information?
The second thing I enjoyed was that the story was created by the main voice cast. While each of the five contributed to the overall story, I found Tabitha St. Germain and Kathy Weislick's contributions to be the best part. Tabitha because of the whole heist theme of the episode that I talked about, but also Kathy because it helped expand on Spike's relation with Twilight and the fact it was thrown a big bone at the end. Very clever, you little dragon.
What? Rainbow! I knew you'd come running when you heard I got this job.
My biggest surprise of this episode, Zephyr Breeze of all ponies. We haven't seen this guy since Flutter Brother of Season 6, but you can actually thank Ashley Ball for wanting to see Zephyr interact with Rainbow again. I guess that's what she enjoyed in her own contribution. I mean, what's next? Rainbow Dash falling head over hooves for that nutcase? The writers are mean tricksters, that's for sure.
Every part of it failed? Oh, now I'll never get the crown!
Much as Slice of Life contributed to its 100th episode, Sparkle 7 contributed to its 200th episode, all with special thanks to the entire main cast for the story. I hope one day they contribute to the next generation of My Little Pony not just by voice, but also by their story ideas as well. Maybe through other cartoons as well. And on a side note, with Avengers Endgame coming around, let's play the Avengers theme just to conclude the review portion of this recap.